Greetings, this is another video overview by the flashlight reviewer Selfbuilt. Today I'm looking at the latest iteration of the Catapult light from Thrunite. For those of you who have been around for a while, the Catapult was one of the first lights produced by Thrunite, now up to version 5, although I've never actually seen a version 4, so I don't know if that existed. Physically, the light has changed quite a bit from the earlier version 3, which I have right here to show you. So I sort of put them side by side. This is the version 3, as you can see on the body label. Overall height, of course, has changed. So you get about the same dimensions here. You can see it's a little bit taller now on the version 5. A lot of that has to do with the head. And you can see that although the overall bezel diameter hasn't really changed all that much, it's just slightly larger now on the version 5, the head has actually had a few changes, the most obvious being the two electronic switches here on the right, and so the larger sort of circuit pill area on the new version 5. You can also see the battery tube is one solid piece now. Before, on the version 3, you had a battery extender, so you could actually run the version 3 as a 1x18650 light. That's not an option on the new version 5. It's a 2x18650 or 4xCR123A in its default form, but I understand you can get an additional extender to increase this out to a 3x18650. For those of you who are wondering, you can't use the battery extender from the old version 3. It doesn't fit. Although the thread diameter is the same in the tail, it has changed here in the head. There's a larger surface area on the new threading, so you can't use the extender from the old version 3. Physically, you'll see the lights look very similar. There's the same kind of checkered pattern for grip. The lights feel equally robust. They're very solid, very heavy duty. So that certainly hasn't changed within the Catapult build. The main change is that you no longer have the physical clicky switch in the tail cap and mode switching by twisties of the head anymore. Now, there's no tail cap switch. That's actually just a solid base, although it's kind of stylized a bit, and with, of course, lanyard attachment points. All mode switching now is done by these two electronic switches in the head, and you can see there's also a small little LED in between them. You might have noticed a couple of blue flashes. It flashes about once every, I think, about 12 to 15 seconds. I haven't measured it exactly. It's a very weak flash. Just let you know the battery's been connected. Because this now is an electronic switch interface, there's always going to be a standby current when the battery is fully connected. Although I've measured it and it's vanishingly small on this sample, so no worries. Yeah, I don't think you'll find any problems at all. You'll see full numbers in my review for what that looks like. Here in the head, and again, I'll just compare it back to the old Catapult 3, you have a very similar sort of reflector setup. You can see there at the base, there's a little hard to tell perhaps, but there's a cool white XM-L2 emitter at the base of a smooth and deep reflector. Reflector looks generally similar to the old Catapult 3. In this case, it was an XML emitter. But again, you know, not a huge difference in the overall reflector kinetics. So I would expect a sort of a reasonable similar beam profile. The reflector does look slightly different in dimensions, so there might be a few changes. But overall, you can expect this again to still be a very heavy thrower. There's also an anti-glare coating on the lens. You can see there's a bezel. Looks very similar to the last one. Cut out so you can, you know, see if the light is on when it's upside down. Little extra crenellations, probably for impact resistance as well. So physically, the light, as I said, is a little bit longer. Overall build looks very similar. If I open it up, let's just start here at the tail cap. As I mentioned, tail cap threading hasn't changed. One difference, however, so you still get these standard triangular threads, but they're good quality. One difference, however, is that they're no longer anodized for lockout. So you can't physically lock out the light like you used to. Not really a problem, again, because the current draw is so small, and there's an electronic light lockout at the switch, which I'll run you through in a minute. If we just close that back up, I'll show you the light at the head. Yeah. So you can see there's a very robust attachment point here in the head. You can see the contact area is very solid. That's mounted under a spring for contact with the head. You can use flat top cells quite comfortably. You can see very, again, robust, in this case, square cut screw threads here in the head. But again, also not anodized for lockout. Personally, I always like a physical lockout option. That being said, you know, you can physically, you can electronically lock out the light here at the switch, which I'll go through the interface, I guess, in a moment. A two-switch interface usually means you'll have one switch to turn on and one to change modes, and that's generally how this works. So the bottom switch is the on-off. When the light is fully screwed together, click it, press it once to turn it on. I find the first time, though, I go to do this, when I've changed the batteries, it doesn't always come on. Try it a second time, there you'll see it comes on fairly consistently. Not quite sure why that is. Anyway, you can see there's a pretty bright beam. You control the output by the second switch up here on the head, and you simply click to move through output mode. So this is the low mode, medium, high, turbo, and then it just cycles back down to low. So the switches are sort of standard electronic switches. They require a click, and you can hear a definite click as you move through the modes. It has mode memory, so if you turn the light off in a certain mode, when you turn it back on, it remembers the last mode you're in and returns to it. So if you like to always have it in turbo, you can leave it there, turn it off, and when you turn it back on, it'll come back on the same mode. So same thing for all the others. That's very straightforward. As you'd expect, there is a strobe mode. When the light is on, again, sometimes this takes extra press there. When the light is on, press and hold the mode-changing mode. And you can see it jumps into strobe. This is a high-frequency tactical strobe, and you can also tell it's an oscillating one. It switches between about 5.5 hertz and 13 hertz. And you'll see, again, oscilloscope traces for that in my full review. Press it again to turn back into regular modes. If you leave it on in strobe mode, turn off the light at the tail switch. When you turn it back on, it defaults to the constant output mode. So there's no mode memory for strobe, as with most lights. But there is an interesting feature on this light. You can activate strobe from off. The way you do that in two ways. In terms of just a momentary, you can just press and release the mode changing switch from off, and it'll come on in strobe. If you want to have it permanently on in strobe, press and hold the switch for at least 3 seconds. Oh, I didn't do it quite long enough there. When you release, let's try that again. When you release, it stays on. So you get a kind of locked in strobe mode right from off, and you can again power off to turn it back off. Turn it back on, it comes on in constant output mode. So very straightforward. As you'd expect, to lock out the light, you can press and hold the electronic switch. You have to do this for about 6 seconds. So after 3 seconds, you'll see there's a flash. Once you release it, the light is now off. It will not come on by the tail cap. To unlock the light, press and hold the switch for about 6 seconds again. Didn't do it quite long enough. And the light comes back on. So, a little bit longer than usual lockout, but it's convenient to have it if you're worried about accidental activation. Because, again, there's no physical on-off. I think, as you can see there, sometimes you need a pretty firm click on the switch. Part of the time, I'm finding light isn't always coming on or going off when I press it. You need to get used to, I guess, the switch pressure and timings to get that more consistently on or off. So as you can see, once I get used to the habit of it, it comes on and off pretty easily. So pretty straightforward interface. Again, very low standby drain. You'll see that in my full review. In terms of the beam pattern, one thing I'll say if I go back up to the high mode, it has incredibly high output for a 2x18650 light. You can see the beam pattern there. As you'd expect, it has a very sharply defined hotspot. Very clear. There's a bit of a corona around it, as you had on the earlier Thrunite lights. But again, all in all, a very focused beam for throw. Overall, kind of typical spill beam width. Output is much higher than I expected. It's much higher than most of my other 2x18650 lights. And you'll see lumen estimates in my full review. The upshot to that, since the output is much higher than my old Catapult, the throw is much further as well. Higher the output, the further the throw. So, an interesting point to keep in mind. Hard to tell beam tint, really, in my office setting. You can probably get the idea it's a bit warmer in the corona than it is in the hotspot or the spill. That's not uncommon with a lot of lights with deep throwing reflectors. You can sometimes see some tint change differences. Again, very firm click to turn that off in the beam patterns. Let me sort of show you the kit that comes with it. It comes in a hard cardboard box. If you open it up, you get sort of the usual items. There's a manual that walks you through all the feature set of the light. You can find more specs online for like runtime and so forth. There is the usual kind of holster. So I open at the bottom, just kind of a basic belt type holster. You have a fairly simple looking wrist lanyard, but at least decent enough quality. And of course, extra O-rings in the package as well. In addition to all that though, my sample also came with a nice additional feature. Which is Thrunite's beam shaper or diffuser. For those of you who are familiar with the old beam shapers from the Surefire lights, this looks very familiar. It's a very solid kind of rubber diffuser. There's a clamp here for pressure, so the way this works is you just slide it onto the top of the light all the way down, clamp to lock it in place so that the beam shaper does not come off. As you can see, obviously now, the light will be very diffused. There's a spring mounted here on the little catch, so you can unlock the diffuser, and then just have the regular beam. So you can run the light in much the same way as before, or flip the diffuser in place and have it kind of lock in place. Now, this doesn't look very diffused in my office. Trust me, in real life it really is. It's just like a foot height. And I'll show detailed pictures in a full review as to what you can expect from the diffuser. But it is a good quality diffuser. It gives you a very nice diffused beam. And if I open it back up, you can just see the full beam pattern again. One comment, as you might have been able to notice if I go really close, the hinge of the beam shaper does put a few little distortions right there on that part of the edge. But they're not really something you're ever going to notice in real life. It's actually a pretty good diffuser for not obstructing the beam too much. So it's very nice to have this kind of option. You can have throw at a glance, or you can just flip down for diffusion. So very nice kind of pattern. Nice to see. I'm glad that they've included it. It feels like a good quality beam shaper, very similar to the ones that I used to get on some of the old Surefire lights. So anyway, that gives you an overview of the performance of the light. For full results and testing, please see my full review at Candle Power Forums, where you'll find me in the reviews forum under the username selfbuilt, or through my personal website at flashlightreviews.ca. Thanks for your time. I hope you found that useful.